السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهداه وبعد. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless every single one of us and to make us from those who are accepted in this month of Ramadan for having fasted for the sake of Allah and for having stood up in the evenings for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for having recited this noble Quran for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for having been from amongst those who are trying their best to understand the word of the Creator. For indeed, without the understanding of the word of the Creator himself, there is no ways that a man would go forward or a woman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all the knowledge of this deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring us closer and closer to him at all times and never ever drift us away. What we have been doing in this month of Ramadan is unique and it is different from what we've done in the past. In the sense that every year, after the Salatul Taraweeh, normally I would get up and make mention of certain verses that were read in the evening in that particular section of the Salah or the prayer Taraweeh. A few years back it was requested that I had gone into reasons of revelations of the verses of the Quran. And Alhamdulillah, that is exactly what happened a few years back, and we went into reasons of revelations which were so interesting. They bring back the core of the Quran and they bring the understanding in everyone's mind that definitely in order to understand the Quran, we need to understand the context in which the verses were revealed. Without looking at that, it would not do justice to the topic of tafsir and we would not be able to understand the deeper rulings of this Quran. We need to know that every verse that was revealed, there was a reason why it was revealed. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us more knowledgeable, because definitely knowledge is an ocean that has no coast at all. And one should seek knowledge up to the last moment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never ever make us feel that we now have all the knowledge that we need to have, because that will never ever be the case in anyone's life. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the best. So this year what has happened is there is a certain type of clustering together of verses of the Quran which are connected to a similar topic in order to look at the angles from which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has discussed these topics. And it is important to understand that every topic we pick up from the Quran, we would definitely realize that it has been discussed from more than one angle. At times, depending on the importance of the topic, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has discussed some of these topics from more than 50 angles, more than 100 angles. And it's amazing how every time a verse is repeated in the Quran, it is repeated for a different reason. Even the stories of the prophets, may Allah's peace be upon them all. Whenever there is the story of Musa alayhi salam, if it is repeated in the Quran, you should know that it is repeated in order to highlight a different point, subhanallah. It is not just repeated the same thing twice without the highlighting of a separate point. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. The Quran is the most powerful book because it is the word of the Creator of power, Allahu Akbar. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a deeper understanding. This afternoon I have decided to speak on a topic that is very relevant to the month of Ramadan. And I'm sure you would be thinking, I wonder what it is. Because the topics relevant to Ramadan, people would say fasting, someone would say salah, someone would say recitation of the Quran. Subhanallah, the topic is the depressing of anger. When I say connected to the month of Ramadan, we need to understand that when a person is hungry, there is an English saying, a hungry man is an angry man. And we realize that in the afternoons of Ramadan, the tempers are running on a thread because people's bellies are empty. Your wife does something, you will blurt out 20 swear words. If that is the case, you have wasted your fast. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells that to us through the Mubarak lips of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. من لم يدع قول الزور والعمل به والجهل فليس لله حاجة في أن يدع طعامه وشرابه. Whoever is not going to fast from bad words, whoever is not going to protect themselves and block their mouths from bad words and evil speech and false witness, then they are wasting their time having abstained from food. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to abstain from food in the correct manner, as well as from bad mouthing and from bad speech and from that which is false and deception in the month of Ramadan. And we should realize that the prohibition of that type of language also extends outside the month of Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Anger is connected to forgiveness. Why do we say this? If you would like to depress your anger, you need to be a very forgiving person. You need to be a person who has a big heart. And you need to realize and understand and think after putting yourselves in the shoes of the other whom you are about to get angry with. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our doors. Mostly people vent their anger on those who are closest to them and most vulnerable, such as their children, their parents or their wives. Thereafter their brothers and sisters. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never to make us from those who do not consider those who are near us, those who are vulnerable and close to us, because the best from amongst you are those who are best to those who are vulnerable. Those who are best to those who are most vulnerable. When you are the best to an orphan child who has no parents, you are from amongst the best. When you are the best to your wife whom you are the one who is now responsible of, and you know that she cannot just turn this way and that way, you know that if she has a complaint, she will complain to you to protect her. When the person who is meant to protect an individual, himself or herself, begins to harm that individual, then that is the greatest oppression. Because you are meant to be looking after this person. How would you harm them? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. And this is why when we are best to those who are closest to us, the hadith says, you are now the best of people. Because then, when there is someone else who is more powerful, more wealthy, someone whom you don't know their exact standing, it is quite easy for you to be good to them because you don't want to have a bad name. But those you live with 24 hours of the day, it is more important as a Muslim that you look after the way you speak to them, because that is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let us go through some of the verses and some of the angles where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has discussed the issue of forgiveness of people connected to the depressing of anger. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verse I'd like to commence with is in Surah Al-Furqan, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the true qualities of the believers. And he says,
وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنًا وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامًا.
The true worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when they walk on this earth, they walk with humility, not with pride, not with arrogance. When a person has pride and arrogance, they tend to become more angry and temperamental. They tend to think that they are the ones, and they tend to think that they are the bosses. May Allah protect us. And this is why pride and haughtiness would destroy an individual. Allah says we need to walk in this earth with humbleness, humility, bearing in mind that you are just a number like everybody else. The best from amongst you are those who are closest to their creator and most conscious of the creator. The best from amongst you is not the tallest or the shortest, or not the fattest or the thinnest, or not the wealthiest or the poorest. No, the best from amongst you are those who are most conscious of their Rabb, of their creator. That is what Allah says. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and this is amazing, that the true worshippers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they walk in this earth with humbleness, and whenever someone ignorant speaks to them, they greet with peace. That means they don't allow themselves to get angry because of foolish behavior and because of foolish statements. If a person wants to control you, all he needs to do is to make you angry, subhanallah. If someone would like, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all, if someone would like, who is a powerful person, to find reason to beat up someone who is weak, all he has to do is sway him,
And if he swears him and that person reacts according to the manner in which the television has instructed him to react, and the rest of the world finds it a normal type of behavior to react, then naturally it would give him reason to beat that man up. And this is very clear and manifest, where if someone were to swear you and then you swear them back, you now become similar in your crime. But if they are stronger than you, you've had it. Because then they will blame you and still beat you. And they will never talk about how it started. Allahu Akbar. They will say, you the one who swore me. And when you say, no, but you swore me, the reality is no one will hear your statement, because the victorious is the one who writes history. In the world, everything we know about the wars of the past, who do we know it from? The winners or the losers? We know it from the winners. And it's possible that it's not even the truth. And this is why what happened in the First World War or Second World War, it's only guesswork, subhanallah. It's only one side of the entire statement. What is happening throughout the globe is only one side of the story, because the story of those who have lost, defeated, dead and martyred, nobody will ever know. So when someone is beaten up, what would happen is their statement would probably not be propelled as the person who's victorious and powerful. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us intellect. This is why don't allow the one who makes you angry to control you. He who can make you angry controls you, because he knows, if I want to destroy this person, I just got to make them angry. So they intentionally swear you to test you, to make you upset. Allah says that is why when those people who want to make you angry talk to you in a way that is about to make you angry, just say peace, not war. Say peace and walk away. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding from that verse. The next verse I'd like to make mention of is the leniency of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam resulted in people understanding and flocking together, and resulted in people accepting the call of Islam, even if it meant years later. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ali Imran regarding the leniency of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says,
فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَظًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ فَاعْفُ عَنْهُمْ وَاسْتَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ وَشَاوِرْهُمْ فِي الْأَمْرِ فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُتَوَكِّلِينَ.
Allah says, it is through the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you were lenient towards them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Had you been severe and hard-hearted or harsh-hearted, they would have definitely flocked away from you, or they would have definitely dispersed from you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so forgive them, fa'fu anhum, and seek forgiveness for them. And also consult them in your affairs. If they are believers, consult them in your affairs. And when you make your mind up, then trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Stop doubting. Allah loves those who trust in Allah. This verse has many lessons. One is we need to be lenient. If we are hard-hearted, if we are harsh in our houses, in our workplaces, when we are on the roads, when we are mixing with others, when we are with our friends, if we are harsh and we are severe and we are hard-hearted, they will not like us. They will disperse from us. Sometimes they will only be close to us because of our might, because of our authority, or sometimes because of our wealth. But in their hearts, they are not with us. May Allah protect us. We would like people who are genuine. When they are with us, they are with us genuinely. When they smile at us, you can see the genuineness through their eyes, that the smile is indeed a genuine smile. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us away from hypocrisy and keep hypocrites away from us as well. Ameen. Then this verse also teaches us that when we have any decisions to be made, we should consult those who have a genuine feeling for us. And once we've consulted and we make our minds up, stop doubting that mind. And don't go back on your word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when you have made your decision, lay your trust in Allah. When you have laid your trust in Allah, then you should know Allah is the best to lay your trust in. Allahu Akbar. Let's move to another verse. Allah commands us to be forgiving. The instruction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, have a big heart, forgive, learn to forgive. Listen to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about overlooking and forgiving in Surah Al-Baqarah. He says,
فَعْفُوا وَصْفَحُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ.
Learn to forgive and overlook until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes with His instruction, with his command. This was for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indeed. But at the same time, the lesson is for all of us. We need to learn to forgive, and we need to learn and we need to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is definitely most forgiving, most merciful. Let's take a look at another verse in Surah Al-A'raf where there is a command. Allah says,
خُذِ الْعَفْوَ وَأْمُرْ بِالْعُرْفِ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ.
Amazing. Allah says, خُذِ الْعَفْوَ. You need to learn to be forgiving. Subhanallah. You need to spread that forgiveness, and you need to instruct people to continue doing good, and you need to continue with that instruction. And Allah says, and turn away from those who are ignorant. Those who are ignorant, what would happen? They must not mislead you. And if you don't turn away from them, you will definitely be misled. Because a person who continues to associate with the ignorant, what will happen to that person? They will be known as ignorant, they will be affected and impacted, and it will have an adverse and negative effect on them whether they realize it or not. For this reason, we need to turn away from those who are trying to earn our anger, or those who are trying to control us through making us upset and angry. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that the forgiveness of Allah is also closely connected to how you are prepared to forgive others. If you forgive others, Allah watches that and He loves that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees that you are forgiving those who wronged you. Allah says, I will forgive you who have wronged me. Subhanallah. That is the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He watches, He gives. Whoever knows that they can execute the frustration they have within them by really punishing the one who's made them angry and still forgives, Allah says, that is the one who deserves to be free from the fire of Jahannam, because I know I can punish that person, but I will still forgive. Allahu Akbar. That is Allah. So every time you get angry, think about the day of judgment and think about how you would like forgiveness. A lot of the verses where Allah says, forgive others and don't get angry, immediately after that, Allah says, look, I am most forgiving, most merciful. Allahu Akbar Kabira. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us a deeper understanding. In Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
إِن تُبْدُوا خَيْرًا أَوْ تُخْفُوهُ أَوْ تَعْفُوا عَنْ سُوءٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَفُوًا قَدِيرًا.
If you are going to show the goodness that you are doing, or you are going to hide the goodness that you are doing, or you are going to forgive people for the evil that they have done against you, then indeed you need to know that Allah is most forgiving, all able. Why does He say most forgiving, all able? Because that is exactly what you would have done to a lesser degree if you forgave someone you knew you could punish, you knew you could fix them up, but you forgave them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah is most forgiving, but He is able to punish you. Allahu Akbar. So the word Qadir comes with Afu in this verse to display the power as well as the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He wants to forgive you, and He at the same time, if He willed, He could have punished you. But because you forgave others, He says He is most forgiving and He is also able. Allahu Akbar. Look at the power of the Quran. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Taghabun,
وَإِن تَعْفُوا وَتَصْفَحُوا وَتَغْفِرُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ.
If you are to forgive, if you are to forgive, and if you are to make amends, and if you are to resolve your matters and problems, you should know Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. Amazing. You are forgiving, you must know Allah is even more forgiving and more merciful. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us from His mercy. Now let's look at something, a different angle. The Quran says a person who has been oppressed, yes, they are instructed to learn to forgive, to try and forgive. But at the same time, that having been said, when you are oppressed once, then twice, then three times, then four times, you need to know there is no oppression in the Sharia. You have a right. And if you are going to give up your right, it's better for you. But if you don't want to give up your right, it still remains your right. What is your right? Your right is when someone has wronged you, you seek revenge, or you seek retaliation, or you may want them to seek forgiveness from you. or you may want to give them a recompense of what they've done. That's your right. Amazing. It is your right. Allah says, look, someone did bad to you, you can do back to them what they did to you. If someone slapped you, you have the permission to slap them back by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا.
Allah says the recompense. Justice dictates that the recompense of a person who has done evil is evil similar to it. Look, Allah says is evil similar to it. Which means if someone slapped you, they've done wrong. You have the right to slap them back. But Allah doesn't call it goodness. Allahu Akbar. The reason is, in Islam, unlike Christianity, which teaches you that you should be giving the second cheek. If someone slapped you on one cheek, give the other one. In Islam, Allah does not tell you you must either give the other one or not give it or slap back. Allah says use your brain to judge the situation. If it requires you to slap him back, slap him back. Allahu Akbar. If it requires him for one smack, you give him 10, you give him 10. Allahu Akbar. If it requires for one smack, you keep quiet and you look at him and smile. Yes, that is what you shall do. And if it requires you to talk to him with your mouth to say, look brother, why did you do this? Then do that. Employ the most beneficial method for you and for him, for your future as well as for your present. That is the Islamic teaching. Subhanallah. That is the amazing power of the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why Allah says you have the right to do that back. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ.
In Surah Ash-Shura, Allah says, whoever can forgive and make amends, bring the people together, their reward will be kept intact for them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thereafter Allah says,
وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَٰلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ.
The most recommended is that you seek, you are patient and you forgive people. That is the most recommended. So give the inclination towards forgiving, though you have the right to revenge and retaliate. The reason why Allah makes mention of revenge and retaliate and retaliation is because people must not get away with the issue of oppression. If they oppress you once and they know you are very forgiving, they'll do it again and a third time and a fourth time until your life becomes a misery and you will die out of oppression. May Allah protect us. Being oppressed to the degree that your health will fail you. So Allah says, imagine if all the Muslims had to forgive everyone who wronged them. By now, they would come to us and kill us off one by one. And we would be saying, nah, forgive, just forgive, yeah, just forgive. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs you to be just before he says, be good. Allah says, you must be just and then you must enjoin goodness. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. We will hear that verse a few moments later, inshallah, in the khutbah. Allah instructs you to be serving or to be holding justice, to be standing firm upon justice and then to ensure goodness. Why that is mentioned in that order is because you cannot just continue telling people, look, just be good, forgive, just be good, forgive, and you are foregoing justice using the name of goodness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us justice, inshallah. Your goodness is your goodness, but justice comes first. If you would like it, then definitely it is your right. Now let's move to another verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in Surah An-Nur about an instruction to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, whose daughter, the most pure of the pure of women, Aisha as-Siddiqah radiallahu anha, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was accused of adultery. Imagine if your wife or your mother or your sister has to be accused of adultery. Allahu Akbar. How you would fume and how you would be standing and sitting and wanting to fix this person and that person. It is human nature. Because the honor and dignity of an individual, when it is ruptured by rumor mongers, or when they try to rupture it by spreading false statements, then definitely it naturally causes great concern in the heart of the one who hears it and who has iman, or the heart of the one who is connected to the individual. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala connect us all as one family. So Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when he heard that statement came from the mouth of one of the biggest hypocrites known as Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. And there were some people who began to spread the gossip. They were equally guilty. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes mention of a certain incident. Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he used to spend money on a certain man known as Misbah ibn Athatha radiallahu anhu. He was a companion and he was related and he was poor. He was extremely poor, and Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu used to give him a stipend every so often. And this man also uttered that statement against Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu's daughter. Imagine, you are spending on people, you are helping them, you are giving them, and still they want to badmouth you. So Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the bare minimum he did, he said, you know what, I'm never ever going to spend on this man again. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed verses to him, which are mentioned in Surah An-Nur.
وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ.
Those who have been granted virtue and those who have been given wealth by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, referring here to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, but the lesson is for all of us. Those who have been granted that type of virtue must not be from amongst those who have promised not to spend on this person and that person, not to spend on those who are relatives and those who are poor and those who have made hijrah and so on. Here referring to Mistah ibn Athatha radiallahu anhu, though the lesson is for all of us, Allah says they must learn to forgive and to make amends, for definitely Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. He will then forgive them in return. You forgive, don't you want for Allah to forgive you? That is what Allah says in the same verse. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? So forgive and make amends. Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. Allahu Akbar. So this lesson is for all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to forgive others wherever they have erred. We need to have a big heart. When you have held what people have done against you in your heart, you fill your heart with rust. And that rust may destroy the shining metal of your entire heart. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Really, what happens is, the heart becomes disturbed, because naturally a heart is an organ that requires purity in order to remain pure with the rest of the organs of the body. If there is something wrong with your heart, you start feeling weak. When there is cholesterol in your heart, you find you lose breath very fast. Your whole body is affected. And when there is spiritual cholesterol, your entire deen is affected. This is why, do not hold excess baggage. Never ever hold excess baggage in your heart. If you are not forgiving someone, that could be your own downfall. No matter what they've done to you, learn deep down to say, Ya Allah, between me and you, I've forgiven this person. If your biggest enemy, this is a very powerful statement, let's listen to it very carefully. If your biggest enemy, who has made your life as difficult as possible, was to get Jannah, subhanallah, what is wrong if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them Jannah on condition, or if He gives you Jannah on condition that He gives them Jannah as well? Nothing wrong at all. What that means is, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells you that I will give you Jannah on condition that your worst enemy is right next to you in Jannah, believe me, it is a bargain. We need to take it. Because the reason is, when we get to Jannah, there's no enmity, there's no hatred. They will be at the best of our buddies. Amazing. If Allah gives us the memory there to remember what happened in the dunya, and I don't think there will be negative memories of anything, because we will be in Jannah, but we will be laughing at it if that is the case. We need to get to Jannah to see firstly if we can remember or not. Allahu Akbar. May Allah grant us all Jannah, inshallah. So this is why a winner is the one who can make a dua, especially now in the last 10 nights of Ramadan. Ya Allah, give my enemies also Jannah. From amongst the Muslimin who have made my life difficult, give my enemies Jannah. When you make that dua, the angels say, oh Allah, give that one even better than what he's asked for his enemies. The angels are making the same dua for you, but it needs a heart made of gold. And gold doesn't rust, inshallah. You see, gold is a metal that won't rust, inshallah. It needs a heart of gold to make that dua empty of rust, free of rust. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the deep understanding. So we nowadays, we hold grudges for the slightest of reasons. Like I said last week, when someone doesn't greet you, suddenly you don't speak to them for 2 weeks, for 3 weeks, for a year, for 2 years. Why? That is shaitan coming to create enmity between us. Don't allow shaitan to win. And why I said at the beginning of this talk that this topic is connected to Ramadan. Shaitan wants to spoil our fast, and generally tempers flare in Ramadan more than they do outside the month of Ramadan. And all of you bear witness to that. Because in the afternoons you find people are driving home and suddenly someone is engaged in a little bit of road rage. The Muslim who is fasting generally, may Allah protect us, I hope we are not from amongst them, generally will start swearing and hooting and showing the guns and probably firing in the air to say, next time you'll see what will happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Just because someone overtook you and cut a little bit tight in front of you, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. That is not the quality of a Muslim. Let's look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding what He will prepare for those who have been forgiving others. Allah says, Jannah and paradise is for those who have forgiven others. Allahu Akbar. Paradise is for those who have learned to forgive others, because when they have it within them, I don't want to forgive, and they still forgive, Allah says, I've prepared for them a special place in paradise. Allahu Akbar. Listen to what Allah says. Many places in the Quran, we'll just mention one or two. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al Imran,
وَسَارِعُوا إِلَى مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَجَنَّةٍ عَرْضُهَا السَّمَاوَاتُ وَالْأَرْضُ أُعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ.
Make haste and compete with each other when it comes to achieving the heaven that is wider than the skies and the earth put together. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it is as wide and even wider. It has been prepared for those who are muttaqeen. And the next part of the verse describes who the muttaqeen are.
الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ.
Allah says three things. Those who spend their wealth at times of difficulty and at times of ease. When you are fearing that you will become poor and still you can take out a portion of your wealth, Allah says, oh, your deed is very high. Allah says, those who spend at times of difficulty and at times of ease. Those who depress their anger and those who forgive others. Allah says, Jannah is prepared for them. Allahu Akbar. Let us understand. Let's depress our anger. Let us learn to depress our anger. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to vent that anger of His, He says we would have destroyed everything moving on earth because of our anger. He said, and they would have deserved it, because day and night, there is a powerful hadith, Qudsi, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, my goodness comes down to my worshippers every day, and their evil comes back up to me every single day. Allahu Akbar. When I send, I only send goodness. And when they give back the deeds are full of evil. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, really. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then tells us in another verse, in Surah Ash-Shura,
فَمَا أُوتِيتُم مِّن شَيْءٍ فَمَتَاعُ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا.
Whatever you've been given in this world, that's just provisions for this world. Anything material you have, it's going to expire. It's going to come to an end. Because when you die, that is the ultimate end of everything material. Then the spirituality comes into place. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَمَا عِنْدَ اللَّهِ خَيْرٌ وَأَبْقَى لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ.
That which is with Allah, which means paradise. Definitely it is more everlasting. In fact, it is everlasting completely. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and it is better for those who believe and lay their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah describes who are those who believe and who are those who lay their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says,
وَالَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشِ وَإِذَا مَا غَضِبُوهُمْ يَغْفِرُونَ.
Allah says they are those who stay away from major sin and from immorality. Major sin they stay away from. Immorality they stay away from. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and whenever they become angry, they quickly forgive and they quickly depress their anger. Allah says, they are the true believers. They are the ones who have laid their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when a person is upset, he then says, Ya Allah, you can see that I am upset, Ya Allah. I am forgiving that person, forgive me. Subhana Rabbi al-A'la. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who have learned a lesson from this afternoon's talk. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who are conscious of their temperament at all times. For indeed, the best from amongst you is the one who can control his temper and his anger. It is reported that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked by a young man, "Give me some advice." He said, "Don't get angry." He says, "Give me more advice." He says, "Don't get angry." He says, "Give me more advice." He said, "Don't get angry." He continued repeating that. That shows us that anger is something that is prohibited in the Sharia. One might ask, why did he keep on repeating that? Maybe he knew that this young man has a very great temper. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all, inshallah, from the coolness of Jannah and the calmness of Jannah in this month of Ramadan, as well as in our temperament and in every single way. Until we continue, inshallah, wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad.
Nabiyyuna al-Hadi Muhammad, al-Qaidul A'la al-Musa.